I'm very pleased to have with me three, you know, really distinguished short story writers. And I'm going to introduce them one by one. And I think we talked about this, how to go about doing this panel. And I thought the best way to go about it is just to talk about a writer that they love, a short story writer that they love, and talk about how that's influenced their own practice. So in that sense, I think, you know, we can generate a much more productive and interesting conversation. So I'm just going to introduce them, and then I'll sort of ask them to talk about a writer they feel enthusiastic about, and how that's influenced their own writing. To my left is Amir Hussain, who was born and brought up in Karachi. He studied Persian and Urdu classics at SOAS in London. His first short story was published in 1987. He has since contributed short fiction to a number of publications, including Critical Quarterly, Wasafiri, The New Statesman, Interlit Q, Asymptote, The Moth, Granta, Caravan, Bengal Lights, and most recently, the anthologies Still and XO Orpheus. He has also contributed fiction in Urdu to Duniazad in 2013. He has been at various times a regular reviewer of fiction for the TLS, the New Statesman, and the Independent. His short stories have been translated into French, Italian, Spanish, German, Arabic, Japanese, and Urdu. He was elected a fellow of the Royal Society of Literature in 2004. He has published two short novels and six collection of stories, including Mirror to the Sun, Cactus Town, and The Swan's Wife, which has just appeared in Pakistan. A retrospective volume is to be published by Bengal Lights, Dhaka, later this year. He divides his time between teaching and writing. Next to Amir is Sabine Javeri, who is an award-winning short story writer, her widely anthologized fiction has been published in the Oxonian Review, the London Magazine, the South Asian Review, Bengal Lights, Wasafiri, World Audience, Trespass, and Sugar Mule, among others. She has won the Oxonian Review Short Story Award and was shortlisted for Meridian, Leaf Books, and the first Tibor Jones South Asia Prize. Sabine holds a master's with distinction from University of Oxford in creative writing and is currently a PhD scholar at the University of Leicester. Her debut novel, Nobody Killed Her, is forthcoming next year by Bloomsbury, UK, US, and India. And to my extreme left is Bina Shah, who I think most of you already know, who is a fiction writer and a journalist in Karachi, Karachi, Pakistan. She is the author of four novels, Where They Dream in Blue, The 786 Cyber Cafe, Slum Child, and A Season of Martyrs. And she's also the author of two collections of short stories. Her work has been published in English, Spanish, German, Chinese, Vietnamese, Urdu, Sindhi, and Italian. She writes a monthly column for Dawn and a blog, 21st Century Woman. She has contributed essays to The Guardian, The Independent, Literary Magazines, Granta and Wasafiri, and the journal Critical Muslim. She became a contributing opinion writer for the International New York Times in the fall of 2013. Her novel, A Season for Martyrs, will be published by Delphinium Books and will be distributed by HarperCollins US in November 2014. Please give them a round of applause. So Amir, I'm just going to start with you. You know, tell us about a short story writer that you love and why has he been or she been important to your practice?
When we first started this conversation about writers that had influenced us or that we loved, I immediately turned back to the time I started writing in the mid-80s and came up with such a long list that it would have been impossible to single one out. And then I remembered what really had influenced me was reading Natalia Ginzburg, an Italian writer, much earlier in the early 70s. She was a writer who flourished just after World War II, and the peak of her career was in the 50s and 60s. But what I had loved really when I read her work was this easy flow from the short to the middle length to the long form. And in fact, she's probably best known for what are called novels but are actually novellas of about 70 or 80 pages. This collection that I really keep by my bedside all the time has in it five short novels, and it's called in Italian Cinque Romanzi Brevi, which means five short novels, but it also has five very short stories attached to it. And her entire oeuvre of short stories throughout her career amounts to only about nine, and that's about 90 or 95 pages. In those short pieces, she's done absolutely everything that for me a writer can do. And mainly, I think what she does is to use language in the most limpid and pure way that translates beautifully into any language at all. And also, she touches you in a way that leaves you absolutely breathless, but she touches you with the simplest and lightest of phrases. I quoted one in my talk yesterday, so I won't repeat it, but perhaps we'll have a chance later to discuss favorite lines or phrases. So I vote for Natalia Ginzburg.
Can you also say how that's influenced your own practice as a writer?
Writing very simply. Sorry, I should have said that. Aiming for simplicity, but not always being bound by simplicity, one. Two, the fluidity of form, so that you're not really worried about what is short or long, but just go on as long as you feel the story demands. I think these are the two major ways. The third thing is that she actually made me write, which is why I went back to that moment of being 22, and, you know, in my gap year. I had left one university and I was going to go to another. And I just filled in my time by experimenting with these fictions that I wrote in Italian, and then realized this is not my language, I can't write in it, I shouldn't be writing in it because it doesn't express my context. And then moved to English, and that's probably where I began.
That's fascinating, because I think that when I read Bruno Schulz, who's this Polish writer that I don't think too many people actually over here know about, but you know, when I read him, he had this really feverish, atmospheric stories that were mostly about, you know, an atmosphere. He's trying to sort of, the spaces in his stories were so alive and so luscious, and I felt that you know, for a long time I just kept writing like that. I think there was a little phrase from that, I think on the first page of that, there was a beautiful image about this girl who was the sister of this boy who sort of returns home. And she says she would come back with a basket full of sunlight. And that image has always kind of stayed with me. Sabine.
Well, being limited to English and Urdu, I haven't read writers in Italian or French. But I remember when I was growing up, I read quite a few American writers, Irish, English writers, but then one day I came across a Lebanese writer called Hanan al-Sheikh, and suddenly I wasn't just reading the story, I was in my head writing a short story as well. Not because of her use of craft or technique, but her use of content. I found her subject matter something I could really relate to. I read a story by her called The Circus, which was about a visit to the graveyard and how everyone dressed up for that visit, because it was Chandra, and you know, everybody was getting dressed up, and regardless of the fact that they were going to a graveyard. And I was like, this could be Karachi, this could be Lahore. And also the fact that she was writing in English, yet was bringing across all the flavors of Arabic without ever using a single Arabic word and without explaining herself. You know, she was, and when she would use Arabic words, she wouldn't bother to explain herself. It was the context that was, you know, explained itself. So definitely Hanan al-Sheikh, because I think she gave me the confidence to be able to write in English while thinking in Urdu, or, you know, being able to transport spaces. Yeah, so that's what influenced me.
You want to talk a little more about how that influenced your own work?
Well, the way it influenced my own work was basically giving me the confidence to be able to write in English, and yet, I was basically fascinated by the way that Hanan al-Sheikh seemed to transport Beirut into London. Basically, the way she was writing in English, but yet sort of bringing across all the flavors of Arabic. And that's something I tried to do in my very first short story, which was called And the World Changed. I tried to, you know, write about the small mohalla in Karachi, and just write it in English without actually using Urdu words, but still bringing that flavor across.
That's lovely. Bina?
Thank you. I don't know how close do we have to be when we're actually speaking into these things.
I don't know. I
have
mean,
to be
actually,
like right
I
here.
Think so. Can you all hear us?
If I talk like this, can you hear me? Wonderful.
I think
okay.
Right. You don't
I great.
I don't want to become a hunchback over this session. Thank you so much for the wonderful introduction, Bilal, and I'm really honored to share the stage with my two colleagues. When you asked me the question, who is the short story writer that has influenced me the most, you really put me into a bind. Because I was racking my brains trying to remember who is it? And so many names came and went through my head. Nobody really satisfied me. And then it hit me, and I felt so stupid for not having thought of this before, that the person who truly has influenced me, I think, over the last 5 years in short story writing is sitting right here with us in the panel. And that's Amir Hussain.
Thank you,
and he's not going to like the answer, but it's true. I first got to know about Amir when I read an anthology, a very famous anthology of Pakistani writing, put out by Oxford University Press. It's called A Dragonfly in the Sun, and it was edited by Muniza Shamsi. And for me, this book was a real revelation because, you know, having been brought up in Pakistan with kind of an English medium education, you read all the English writers, and for me, I read all the American writers. I had an American higher education, college education, university education. So America was all that I could think about. And then I came across this anthology of Pakistani writers writing in English. For the first time, my eyes were open to our own traditions, but not in our indigenous language, in English, which was the most accessible to me. I came across somebody called Amir Hussain. And I loved the story that was there. And I was really lucky enough to travel to London that summer, 1999, and meet him in person. And it was a conference at the South Bank Center on South Asian writing. I met Babsi Sidla and I met Amir. And we lost touch after that, but we got back into touch when I reviewed his short story collection, Insomnia. What year was that, Amir?
It would have been when the Pakistani edition came out in 2008, I believe.
Okay, so we're talking 6 years ago. And I wrote to him and I said, you know, I loved your short story collection and I'm going to review it for the Dawn Books and Authors. And out of that contact, the most amazing correspondence developed between he and me. And we talked about so much about literature. But more than just talking about writing and literature, he shared with me the construction of his stories as he was writing them, especially with his novellas. Not so much the short stories, but with the novellas, he's written something called Another Gulmohar Tree, and he's written The Cloud Messenger, which are really two seminal works in Pakistani English literature. And so he would send me bits and pieces and fragments and stories and sections, and I would read them. I got to see really how he operates, how he put these stories together, how he pretty much sculpted them out of fine clay, because that's really the best image I can use to describe these short stories. They're exquisite, they're elegant, they are full of compassion for the characters. You read each page is brimming with love for characters that you come to the book, you don't know these people, you leave the book and you're sorry to see them go. He can do that. And I wanted to start doing that in my own writing. And I think unconsciously, I never set out to copy anybody, but unconsciously I modeled my writing of compassion to his example. And what I also very much liked about his short stories is how he treats women, the women characters in his short stories. You don't get men that can write women characters. You have men and they write these two-dimensional caricatures, these sex objects or these, you know, romantic figures and idols and heroines. And Amir takes women and they're real and they spoke to me. And so I just found everything that I needed to find in a short story in whatever he's produced.
That's fantastic. We want to say a little bit about how, maybe a specific example of how, you know, interacting with his work influenced your own writing.
Yes, when I was writing my novel, which Amir calls the Great Sindhi Novel, that's A Season for Martyrs, GSN, and, you know, I would send my work to him, which is what writers do. We collaborate, and that's one of the most beautiful parts of being a writer, is finding your co-conspirator, really, which Amir was for me for many years and still is. And just being able to say, this works for me, this doesn't work for me, I like this part, I don't like this part, why don't you try it like this, why don't you try it like that? And although I would consider him to be really one of the statesmen of Pakistani literature, I use that word very purposefully, but he actually gave me the respect of taking my work seriously and understanding it and really bringing out the best of it. So I was lucky. I had pretty much my own private MFA going on.
Whoa, that's really lucky, yes, I have to say. Okay, the other question that I want to direct to Amir and then maybe Sabine can pitch in, Sabine and Bina can pitch in, is the question of the short story form. Because writing and sustaining a long narrative like a novel requires certain architecture that perhaps in many cases is not required for a short story. Some of the best short stories read like revelations, right? They're just there. But I think this was an experience that I went through when I was trying to, you know, put together this novel in 9 stories. That I realized that, you know, putting a larger narrative together requires a completely different architecture. It requires a completely, exerts all sorts of pressures on the short story, on its both thematically and structurally, that is perhaps not required for a short story, but short story, to write a good short story, has its own kind of poetics. What would you say to that?
It definitely has its own poetics, and I think one of the things for me is that I very often think in fragments and scenes and images. And actually, if I have about 11 images to put together, it's already enough work to try to fit those into 10, 15, 20 pages. To think of composing a whole book in that way is really quite difficult, and I made the effort when I was doing The Cloud Messenger, which is in fact a patchwork of fragments and so on and so forth, and I found it quite exhausting. Other than that, I think in a short story you have to control the chronologies very carefully, so that even if you're covering 100 years in 5 lines, you still have to be very, very, very adroit and deft at doing it. Whereas in a novel you have space to develop, but the writer has to stay with all those years, the writer has to stay with all those vast casts of characters, which personally I find very tedious. So when people say it's actually harder to produce a short story than a novel, I say no, it isn't. It might be harder to produce a very good short story than it is a novel. But a novel is a kind of task that I don't think a short story writer wants to undergo, until it comes to collecting the stories into a volume, which then is another task, possibly similar to the novel, which perhaps you can say something about later. But it's a completely different thing. I think that long short story, as they call it in America, or the novella, as some people call it, or just the long story, is probably closer in spirit to the short story and easier for the short story writer to work on. So for me, just as I was saying about Natalia Ginzburg, to sort of run into 60 or 70 pages is not such a great effort. Once I go beyond that, I'm in a field, I'm in a land that I don't know. It's unknown terrain, and I really feel that I'm out there with not enough luggage or not enough equipment.
Yeah.
Or rather that I am in a space that I don't want to be holidaying in. Whereas with a short story, I just know I can manage it, you know?
Yeah.
A draft can come in a day or half a day, and then you can spend 2 months perfecting it, which I often do.
Yeah.
Whereas with a novel, you can do a chapter faster, but putting all those chapters together is really a chore.
What do you think,
Sabine?
That's
a novelist.
I started out writing short stories, so for me it was like a snapshot, and I was a bit limited for time because I have 2 young kids. So short story was all I had time for, and I really began to enjoy it because for me it was like, you know, just capturing a specific moment in time and just that particular feeling or that particular image or incident. But then later on, when I decided to write a novel, it was a very conscious effort. I construct it, I planned it, I planned chapters, and I'm not embarrassed about that because, you know, I mean, it was something new for me, and
yeah.
I went about it very systematically, and, you know, I planned it. And once I did that, I began to really enjoy it, and I began to find the short story form very constricting.
Yeah.
And I began to enjoy writing the novel because I felt that it gave me more space to explore my characters.
That's
quickly.
Right.
So I switched camps, and I became a traitor, and I started enjoying the novel.
Yeah, I think there was a J.D. Smith essay where she said there are two types of writers. One are micromanagers and others are macro planners. And micromanagers, and she describes herself as one, are the ones who do not know what's going to happen next. They write one word, one sentence, one paragraph at a time. And macro planners are ones who need to have the entire structure in place before they put pen to paper. Or fingers to the keyboard, as the case may be.
I still didn't know how it would end, because you know I even have it tattooed on my hand. I'm Joby Hosoho, so I thought, you know, whatever happens will happen. But I wanted a structure in place. You know, I wanted the characters to have a proper arc. I wanted there to be redemption, and you know, I wanted the reader to feel that there is a proper story arc. You know, because writing a short story, I could afford to sort of leave it loose-ended.
That's right.
Because it was just, you know, one snapshot, one peek through the window. But for a novel, I did go about preparing a whole journey.
And that's one of the big differences between a novel and a short story, right? Bina, what do you think about this?
Well, you're catching me at a very bad time in my career right now, because I am trying to write a novel and a short story, and I'm stuck in the middle of both. So I'm very frustrated with both formats.
Maybe here's an opportunity for you to work it out.
Help me.
Drop the novel, finish the short story, go back to the novel.
Okay, we're done. Bye. I think a lot of people think, and this is a big mistake to think this way, that the short story is practice for the novel. Huh. It is not.
No, it's different.
So when you're writing a short story, you're dealing with a completely different kind of animal than a novel.
That's right.
And I have heard everything said about the short story. It requires more effort, it's more precise, it's more intense. And I found that the same is exactly true of the novel. It is more intense, it's more precise, it's more this. I've heard the novel is more sprawling, you have more space, you can do this, you can do that. I found the same thing is true when you're working on the short story. I think it all boils down to what you are as a writer, who you are as a writer, as Sadie Smith says. You're either the micromanager or you're the macro planner.
Yeah.
You're going to have to be both. You can't be either or. I disagree with her. If she were here today, I would say, I'm sorry, Ms. Smith, you've won every prize there is on the planet, but I still disagree with you. You have to be able to micromanage everything in your novel and your short story, and you have to be able to macro plan both your short story and your novel. Hmm. And the same things are requirements for both: the attention to detail, the precision of language, the control of characters. You have to control your characters as much in a novel as you do in a short story. The difference being that perhaps it takes you longer to write the novel, and you become more sloppy when you're writing the novel because you think, well, here's a loose end, I'll tie it up later when I go back to it, and when I do the third draft and the fourth draft. And those things can really get you. They can make your work a lot harder. Whereas in the short story, you pay more attention to the detail as you go. So perhaps in the revisions, it may not be as painful of a job if you feel you've gotten it right from the beginning.
Mm.
But I think both have different kinds of energy. You're talking about a marathon versus a sprint mm-hmm. when it comes to a short story. The editing process is equally painful for both. Mm. So I would say that having done many short stories and having done now 6 full-length novels and trying to work on a 7th, no, is it 4 and trying to work on a 5th? This is why I'm a writer, not a mathematician. It's just an intense commitment, no matter what scale you're working on. And it's hard. And just don't do this, because you don't get any money out of it anyway. So,
Can I ask something, if you guys don't mind?
Yeah.
I'm interested in knowing Bilal's views as well, because I think he's a fantastic short story writer. I find that when I'm writing a short story, because it's quick, or at least for me, you know, I'm still with the characters, I'm still feeling the same way I am when I'm writing it. But with a novel, because it's a longer process, I am also changing as a person, and I don't necessarily am the same person as I was when I first started writing the novel. And I'd be interested to know how you feel about that. Do you change as a person when you're writing a longer piece, and how do you deal with that when you go back to revisions?
Yeah, I get old. I get really old. I feel like I age 100 years when I'm writing a novel, even if it only takes a year or 2 years.
Metaphorically, you know.
metaphorically. Now, there comes a certain point in your life, and you haven't reached this point yet because you're very young, when your core pretty much fixes, and then you are who you are, and that won't change quite as much, as drastically as it will when you're in your 20s or when you're in your 30s. So you come to it from a more solid place. Yeah. And so you're able to anchor the novel in yourself. And, you know, writing is as much of the body as it is of the mind. Yeah. You feel things very physically, you feel things at a muscular level. When I finished the novel that's going to publish in November, I cried. I cried when I wrote the ending. I wasn't expecting that kind of emotional response. But it's through your whole body, and our bodies are very much the vessels of our art, as much as any dancer,
yeah,
as much as a musician, a painter. And so there comes a point where that kind of solidifies. It comes into, I wouldn't say stasis, but it comes into a holding pattern. And then perhaps you're able to much more grapple with the length that it takes to write the novel. You can hold it. You can hold parts of it in yourself, in different parts of your body. Now I'm sounding crazy, but these are things that you can do to maintain the integrity of the novel over that amount of time.
No, I think what you've said is just gorgeous. You know, I have a Venezuelan friend who's much older than me, and one of the things that she told me is that, look, when we read from our entire body, right? We feel this fear for this character in our stomach. We have like these goosebumps. We literally read with our bodies, but when we write, we tend to think that we can only write from our brain.
Not true.
And what we write needs to be entirely intelligible to us and to ourselves. Whereas one of the main reasons why you choose to write about something is because it puzzles you, you don't understand it. And reading it, writing it is one way of engaging with it, trying to battle with it. And so, you know, your language and your work shows some, you know, best writing actually shows the battle scars of engaging with something that's difficult, that's hard to confront otherwise. Amir?
My first loves are music and poetry, so for me the short form is always the most important. And I think that I'm hugely moved by reading a poem. I can probably think of more short stories that have moved me than entire novels, because they're parts of novels that move one. And as a writer, I've actually been changed and transformed by some of the stories I've written. I'll just give one very brief example. Some years ago, I set out to write a story which just touched on partition in 1947. I happened to pass through a place where there had been refugees for many months, and I didn't know that that was the place. Actually, writing the story transported me to that place, and I came out actually knowing more about those experiences in Delhi in 1947 than I had known when I began. Later, reading about them made me realize that what I had intuited during the writing process was all true. So I think the short or the long form, it depends on the moment, it depends on the passage, it depends on the chapter. You can be transformed by it. I think writing transforms you, or music transforms you. And the creation of it, of course, is, you know, making you a part of that whole process of the genre you're working in.
Can I just add something here? Cool. In that, what Amr said just reminded me of what I've done with the novel that's coming out, which is, it takes place, there are two threads going on in the novel. There's a contemporary thread that takes place in the last 3 months of Benazir Bhutto's life. And interspersed into this narrative thread of the 3 months is vignettes from Sindhi history. And they're standalone stories, actually. And so I think when I was writing the novel, I was actually not wanting to give up the short story. I loved the short story form so much that I found a way to weave it into the larger narrative of the novel. And I was thinking about this vis-a-vis your book as well, Bilal, and we didn't get to talk about it in your launch yesterday, but where you also have created a novel in 9 parts, and they are also standalone stories. And so what we're seeing, I think, is a kind of hybridization,
yeah,
between the novel and the short story, and it challenges the conventional structures and the conventional traditions of both forms.
Yeah.
Maybe I could put it to the panel if you think also, if you think this is also happening in your own work and how you feel about that, or are you a traditionalist and you want to keep, Amir, I know you have something to say about this.
I just have one word, no, it isn't happening, it won't happen.
Okay. I also find that quite difficult. I can't do a cycle of stories. For me, each short story is standalone. It's just a moment, you know, something that I'm feeling. because this is something that I'm really struggling with. You know, I've been asked to write a series of short stories, a cycle, but I'm finding it very difficult. I'd be really interested to, I mean, you just said that for you, it's a natural process. Am I right?
It just happened with this book. It just kind of seemed to be the right thing to do because I wanted to tell a modern story and I wanted to portray the history of Sindh as well and how else to do it but through vignettes, fictionalized versions of historical and mystical and sort of mythological events that we've all heard told to us but I don't think have ever actually been set down in fiction in this form before. So I really set out to do that. That was actually a very conscious decision in the larger frame of the work.
What about you? Did you find it easy to
For me, like, you know, the project was to sort of, you know, it was, the stories were kind of emerging out of particular experiences and they were standalone. And again, I'm somebody who's read lots of short stories and from all over, and I'm a big short story buff. So I think my mind was working in the short story form as well. I think that, you know, the shapes that stories would take were that of short stories. But I, you know, after about writing half the book, I realized that all of them were kind of about the same thing. And then I kind of, you know, started working toward a formal structure that would accommodate all of them. It took me a long time to figure out what that formal structure would, what that formal structure be, how that's going to work, what would be the thematic elements, and how that would, how I would be able to accommodate them. I don't think that I've been successful entirely myself, but I think that, you know, I think one tries to be as honest as one can to, you know, one's limits. I think that this is one of the things that, you know, as a writer you confront all the time, is that, you know, your own limits, you know, limits of your understanding of things. And I think that, you know, the writers that I admire are the ones who are not afraid to confront those limits. And I think the writers that I don't like are the ones who are trying to conceal that, conceal the fact that, you know, they are limited in all number of ways. I think large part of being a writer for me is to be able to confront, you know, the limits that I have, both as a person, as a writer, and as somebody who thinks about the world. So I think that for me, you know, writing and writing fiction particularly allows me no space to hide, and, you know, allows me to kind of confront that more directly. Okay, so I think we can open it up for questions. How much time do we have?
We've got 25 minutes.
25 minutes, excellent. So I think we'll have plenty of time for questions. Okay.
And there are no questions.
Do we have a mic that can go around? I think there's a hand up there. No?
Have we said
okay.
So much?
There's a hand up here as well.
Binasha made a comment towards the end of the discussion that if that it doesn't really pay well to write. So I just found that a little funny, so I would just like you to kindly explain, you know, just for maybe for young aspiring writers, what kind of advice would you give them to have a regular profession and then write just for pleasure, or could a youngster take it up seriously, English writing? Thank you.
I can't answer for everybody. Maybe somebody's got a trust fund so they can afford to just live and write in Paris or something. And for most people that want to write, they need to take up jobs. They need to, the two most common professions that aspiring writers take up are either in journalism or teaching writing, some aspect of it. That's a way to do it.
Marrying rich as well, I think.
Marrying rich.
That would work.
Yeah, that hasn't worked for me so far. But but you have to think carefully because these are all devil's deals. Now, when they, you know, in the 1800s or the 1900s, people could just say, "I'm going to be a writer. I will live in poverty and I will just suffer for my art, and I don't care if I have to eat soup every day as long as I write." And we don't seem to be making these sort of choices in our modern world. So you have to think very carefully. What is your balance going to be? Know that if you take a full-time 9-to-5 job, you won't have a lot of time or energy for your own writing. know that if you take a teaching job which gives you summers off and lots of vacations and time, you won't be making a huge salary. You'll make a modest living. It'll be a good one. So just, you know, I think before you decide on the practicalities of how you're going to do your life as a writer, decide if you really want your life as a writer, and then go from there.
Harun. Hi, so my name is Harun, and I would like all of your feedback on this. So right now, perhaps, as a writer, I'm thinking of experimenting with a piece of writing which incorporates fiction as well as non-fiction, as well as journalism, as well as poetry. So perhaps, is there room to sort of scope to put together so many different forms of writing into one piece of writing?
I think we, two of us, seem to be saying the same thing. Why not?
Yeah.
Now, examples come to mind of a more dynamic period in world literature, or certainly in Anglophone literature, the 80s perhaps, in which people were producing hypertexts, which, you know, had elements of all these different things. You can think of someone like Kathy Acker, who might not have been doing the kind of thing you're talking about, but she was producing novels that weren't what we would traditionally call novels, and they allowed for different genres to be intermingled. I think that can be done, but I do feel we're living in a very, very conservative age as far as publishing is concerned. And as far as publishing in the West is concerned, what used to be perfectly eligible as you know, to be published is now simplified, dumbed down by editors, by young people very often who don't even know what they're reading, and they tell you, oh, why can't this be linear? Their favorite question, the favorite editorial blue penciling you get in the margin is, I was confused by this. So, yes, do it, risk it, be bold, and be ready to be told that it's not working with the editor or the publisher. Keep trying.
I mean, I think that, you know, this distinction in genres is a fairly recent thing in human history. I mean, you know, people never made this distinction, oh, right now I'm going to write a short story or a novel or a longer form narrative, right? I mean, people would express, I mean, I think it's about what you want to write about. If what you want to write about needs to be accommodated in many different forms, why not? I mean, form is just a way to, you know, to say what you want to say more effectively.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if, you know, your content seems to be spilling over in all sorts of different things, why not? I mean, you know, what you want to have at the end of it is something that's absolutely beautiful and amazing. I think that that's what the aim is. The aim is not to sort of, you know, get caught up in this idea that, you know, I'm going to write a short story, or I'm going to write a novel, or I'm going to write a poem. The idea is to sort of write something where you can be most honest to yourself and also to what you are kind of writing about, ultimately. That's the...
And if there was no experimentation, then there would be nothing new, you know.
Yeah, I can't add anything to that. We don't make the rules. You want to do it, do it. If it sucks, you'll find out soon enough.
Yeah, I think Flannery O'Connor said something really interesting there. She said, you know, you can do anything you can get away with. The only thing is, not many people have gotten away with much.
Yeah.
Right? So, okay. There's Ilona, and then we will come to you, yeah?
It's probably been asked this question before, but it's regarding creative writing schools. So does that help you in your writing? And if so, how? Does it change the way you express yourself? Does it help you develop better than if you just read extensively and start to try right from the bottom of the hill?
Don't you love Hanif Qureshi's recent essay about how he teaches creative writing, but he thinks it's useless to teach it? Oh, go and look that one up. You'll get your answer right there. He doesn't know what he's talking about, basically.
You know, I have a master's in creative writing, and I'm also doing a PhD, a creative PhD. I don't think creative writing courses can teach you how to write, but I do think they can guide you what to do with your writing. You know, they can introduce you to the right people, they can sort of tell you, help you identify publishing trends, you know, they can get you an internship in a publishing house. So I don't think they can teach you the craft, I don't think they can help you with technique, I don't think they they can teach you how to write, basically. But I do think that, you know, if you want to take your writing further, if you maybe want to get into publishing or into magazine editorship or, you know, make a career out of it, then sometimes it's almost like getting a master's in archaeology or any other degree. You know, they just guide you what to do with this skill that you have.
In, let's say, editing or let's say publishing, but yeah. not in your own craft. It won't help you or it...
Well,
it can polish it, certainly, but I don't think it can basically teach you how to write. I think that has to be intuitive, that has to come from within. But yes, it can help you, you know, help you polish your work, it can help you exchange ideas with like-minded people, you get to meet new people, you get to meet, you know, people in the industry. You know, after I did my master's, I got into publishing. I you know, got an internship with Random House, Jonathan Cape, and I think without the know-how, I don't think I would have been able to. So.
Well, I think that, you know, I mean, my experience has been, I went for an MFA, and then now I teach at LUMS. I teach creative writing at LUMS. I think my experience has been that, you know, it's different for different people, right? I mean, I think for some people, they really value just the time that they have to write while they're in an MFA program. Time, opportunity, and deadlines, right? So some people, that for some people, that's incredibly useful. For others, you know, it's the fact that they find a community of writers, something that Beena touched upon earlier, that you find, you know, a group of people who are also interested in writing, who write. You form that community that, you know, lasts you, you know, a lifetime sometimes. And for some people, it is the business side of things, right? I mean, so, you know, you get introduced to publishers, you know how to, you know, who to approach once you finish your manuscript, what to write in a pitch letter and so on. I mean, I did not make use of that, but, you know, but you know, some of the people, you know, make use of that. For some people, all this entire experience is incredibly stifling at the same time. You know, I had friends who just hated the fact that, you know, they were paying $50,000 for somebody, you know, to read their work. I mean, I was on a scholarship. I did not pay $50,000. So, I mean, again, I think it's very different for different people. And, I mean, as far as I was concerned, I think I really learned something about technique of putting together narratives. How do you construct narratives? What are the elements? How can you make a story interesting? How to write a good sentence versus a bad sentence? Reading closely, reading intensely. I think all of those things really, you know, is really forms the core of yourself as a writer. So I think that, you know, the MFA experience, one of the things you'll realize is as varied as the personality types who are kind of.
Can I just add that I had to throw away the novel that I wrote during my master's in creative writing. So it did not help me at all with writing my novel. And I would also refuse to pay for a creative writing master's. And I only did it because I got a scholarship as well. So.
Okay, we have a hand up here and then we'll switch to that side.
To all of you, I was wondering if any of you suffer from writer's block, and if so, how do you get past it?
My whole life is writer's block.
I only write if I really have to, if I'm constrained by deadlines, if I'm feeling sick with a story. So it's about, you know, if it's journalistic writing or reviews, it's really discipline. If it's fiction, my limit is about 2 a year.
No, like Shobhade said, I can't afford writer's block either, you know, because I have young kids, I have a job, I have my research, so whatever little time I get to write, I write. I just really treasure it.
I'm suffering from it right now, and it's very frustrating. What am I going to do about it?
That's one thing.
Yeah, panic.
You do that a lot.
Yeah, this is basically the writer's life. Writer's block is part of your life. So don't think of it like cancer that you're supposed to try and avoid it. And if you take vitamin W, you won't get it, and so on and so forth. No, you're going to get writer's block. Everybody burns out. Everybody does too much and then hits the wall and then they have to stop for a while and then they should... Yes, Amir?
Mine isn't even block. It's just total disinclination to sit around.
Yes, I don't
when
want to...
When people write such good stories, Burns, when they sing beautifully, when they talk entertainingly, why would I be sitting alone in a room and wanting to write?
Yeah.
I have this fantasy of picking up my computer and hurling it out the window.
I have done.
This is... You've done it. Yeah, you now you're hearing about the real dirty secrets of writers' lives. And yeah, it's just, what are you going to do?
Yeah, I think, laziness is such an important part of being a writer's
block. Yeah, oh yeah.
And I think that, you know, I mean, I've not had a writer's block. I mean, I just like, you know, switch to doing something else.
You're too young, Bilal.
No, that's true.
do either of you write on a desk?
No, I write everywhere. No.
I write on my
on a plane.
Yeah. In a bathroom.
Yeah.
Let's
yes,
not.
Yes, I do that too.
That. Okay. The gentleman over there. Yes.
Right next to you. Yeah.
Can you hear me? Yes. I'm very interested in the short story as a form. And you know, every holiday house you go to, every downstairs loo, has collections of Somerset Maugham.
Yeah.
And nothing by Joyce. You don't see collections of Dubliners and. My grandparents, who didn't go to university, used to say, I like a short story because I like the twist. is there any reason why Somerset Maugham is so popular, and should we be worried about that?
Somerset Maugham popular in Pakistan?
Anywhere.
Anywhere?
He was my favorite writer when I was 19. I lived of human bondage. I worshipped Cakes and Ale. I mean, I thought he was the greatest thing ever. And then I grew up. So perhaps he's popular with people who are attached to a particular time and place, and they think that that's what defines them, so they don't want to give him up, and they put him in your bathroom.
Purely formally, they're very easy, accessible magazine stories. Mm. And they were probably written for a fee for a glossy magazine at the time. They have a lot of description, they have sort of catchy emotional situations. And yeah, I have a couple of Somerset Maugham anthologies floating around, which I dip into from time to time. I think popular writers can very often give, you know, the more pretentious among us some good clues about how to get on with the narrative. Mm.
Mm. Yeah, I think he's out of vogue now. I don't think he's as popular. In fact, I have an anthology which was compiled by Clifton Fadiman, I think back in the 80s. And he said that he's out of vogue now. So, you know, I think he's been out of vogue for a while. I mean, but you do see his books everywhere. I agree with that.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, this gentleman.
Sir, we can't hear you.
Hello.
No.
I would like to ask that if when you start writing a story, do you have some moralistic point of view or an ideology in your mind, or as the story goes forward, it just unfolds, or you remain totally objective towards the end of the story?
Okay, I'll take that first because I have a short answer. I wouldn't write fiction if I wanted to start off with anything ideological. I would go straight into memoir and essay. Like very recently I had the experience of writing about visiting Palestine. There was no way I would try to make that into a story. I sat down and churned out an article in a way that I normally wouldn't do. The story usually starts with an image or a deep feeling.
For me, yeah, there's no such thing as ideology in fiction. That is the domain of different kinds of writing. Fiction is art. For me, I start out thinking, I want to write a story where, dot, dot, dot. And the dot, dot, dot can be something like, I want to write a story about a boy who can talk to cats. I want to write a story about a strange museum in the middle of Rome. I want to write about, you know, Shad al-Latif Bitai. So it changes, but you have to kind of have it closed and open at the same time. Closed in the sense that you want to say, this is what my story is going to be about. Maybe these are the people that are going to be in it. And then you're going to say, I don't know what's going to happen. And that sounds a little strange, but you do need to leave that uncertainty there so that while you're writing, you can allow for the unexpected to happen in the story.
Yeah, I like the way you put it, but it's also, I like the way that Veena has put it, but I also agree with Amir that for me, also it just starts with an image, or maybe something I've heard, and I take it from there. But you know, like she said, it's open-ended, and how it's gonna unfold, I don't know. would like to.
Yeah, I mean, I think my answer is over here. I mean, I completely agree with everything that's been said. But I mean, it reminds me of a small anecdote of, you know, one of my professors who was once asked by an interviewer, do you write about real people? So you would look at the person asking him the question. He says, yes, and people just like you, and I'm always right. So, anyway, there was a hand up there. Yeah, that gentleman.
Hello. I have a couple of questions. You're all distinguished and published writers. So I wanted a bit of inside information. Okay, how does a writer, like a budding, like an amateur writer, go about getting his work published, especially if he's living in a place like Pakistan and Islamabad? And secondly, what kind of market does English literature have?
Okay, Bina was going to answer that question. I forgot to ask you that question. Sorry, Bina.
What's the question?
Market. For short stories.
Yeah.
And how does a writer go about finding avenues for publishing?
How do you make the money?
You
know, it's an important question, but if you make that the center of your focus as a writer, your writing career is going to go there. So I would say that maybe if you already read stories somewhere, like maybe there's a magazine or a journal that you really like, and you've read stories there before, and you might think about what could I get my story into that same magazine. So you could start with that kind of idea. If you go online, there are so many websites where they publish fiction. There are literary journals, there are webzines, there are blogs, so on and so forth. They have submission guidelines. You can always just, for fun, I surf the web at night and I look at different journals and I look at their submissions criteria and I think about what I'm working on or could I do something that would fit what they're looking for. So you kind of have to be out there looking, and we are very lucky to have the internet, which brings all those opportunities right into our laps, really, before you'd have to write away on, what is that thing they call, paper and the pen? And send a letter and ask, and it would wait weeks for it to come back. So today you've got the ease of email. So you can just be on the lookout for any kind of opportunities that there are. I don't think it's as hard as it used to be.
I'll just add to that, look out for fellowships. I've just been judging one called the Martin Pick Fellowship. And students from Charles Pick Fellowship. Yeah, students, writers from South Asia send in stuff. And one of the joint winners of this year is, in fact, someone from Pakistan. So it's well worth looking into that. They allow you to come over for, is it 6 months, and to stay there and spend time writing your work with a mentor. So these things are also a way of developing your craft.
Okay.
Yes. I have this question, keeps coming to my mind. So, how important is, Bilal, you said that short story writing is like a revelation. Something to that effect, you said.
Sometimes.
Yes. So how important is the shock factor in...
Oh. I don't think...
This takes a while to come back on.
Okay. I don't think there is one kind of short story. Like there isn't one kind of any literary activity, any literary form. So I think that, you know, but there are short stories that look like revelations. That there are short stories that look like poems. There are short stories that look incredibly constructed and that are incredibly constructed. So there are all sorts, really. And again, you know, there are certain short stories where the shock factor is important, but there are certain short stories, and in fact, somebody mentioned Joyce. There is no big bang in Joyce. There is no big bang in Chekhov, who's, I think, one of the most important short story writers. At least for me personally, he was the writer I was in conversation with early on when I started off writing. So I think that, you know, I mean, there are as many kinds of short story writers as there are kind of short stories, and there isn't really one thing. I mean, it depends on what you are trying to do at different points in time. for O. Henry, you know, shock was it, right? The whole idea of
twist
a short story.
The tale.
Yes. Or you know, for some of Manto, again, not all of Manto, shock, he used shock as an important effect to make you confront certain things that would be hard for you to confront otherwise, or you would not confront otherwise, or would not confront it in that way otherwise, right? His entire collection, Siyah Hashiye, are these really short snippets of
flash fictions.
You can call it flash fictions, right? We were talking about it, right? I mean, Manto did not worry about whether this was poetry or short fiction or short prose. He just wrote something where he felt that this was the way to do this, right? So, you know, I hope I've answered it.
I'll just add that in the novel that I recently finished, I had a twist, I had a shock in there, and my agent said, take it out, it's not working. It's often when you try for shock, you get Jeffrey Archer, and you don't want to be Jeffrey Archer, so don't do that.
Tone of thought or
good
sorry.
Writing. If writing is good, if we do our job right, then we do that.
Yeah, it was just something that makes you think. Actually, and shock factor is a strong word that I used. Something that makes you think differently, maybe. So I think short story is a very good medium for that kind of thing.
Well, look at Manto's Toba Tek Singh, which not everybody on the panel likes, but I'll just use it as the example that was real shock factor. And Manto used it to good effect. I mean, it's one of the most memorable short stories that we have coming out of South Asia. So, yes.
I think the last lines of a short story are almost the most important thing. The story has to end beautifully. So whether it has a shock in it, or it has a revelation, or it just has a dying fall, as some people call it, is all in the hands of the practitioner. Some people use it in too facile a fashion. I've recently been rereading Laurie Moore, a very famous American short story writer. And she started to depend so much on the beautiful ending that, for example, you can read 30 pages to reach that. So whether it's a shock at the end or just a beautiful epiphany, I think it's equally important to have something that leads up to it. Even if it's surprising, it should still be, you know, the journey should be worth making before you reach the shock or before you reach the beauty or the revelation.
I just want to quickly add that I think there's a difference between a shock and a twist. I think it's different when you're, you know, leading up the reader, and then there's a twist, and you lead them, you know, in shock. But there is another kind of shock, like maybe Thanda Ghosht by Manto, where the shock is that the reader realizes what he's actually talking about, and that I think that is something that really makes a short story special. Not everyone can do that, but the way Manto does that, I think, is amazing.
Okay, I think we are out of time. Thank you all for coming. Thank you to the panelists for being here. Their books are available. Please, get them signed if you want. And thank you all for coming. Have a good
thank
evening.
Thank you, Bilal, for the wonderful session.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, guests, for such a wonderful conversation.